Welcome to M Squared, a channel where we're going to take a look at some of the unsung heroes in the history of science. For generations, women with a bent for education had to fight for their right to study. One of the brightest mathematical minds in the 18th and 19th centuries was Marie-Sophie Germain, a French mathematician who made contributions to elasticity theory, number theory, who stole a man's identity to attend university and saved Gauss from certain death at the hand of the French army. She was born in April 1776 in Paris. As a young girl, she found herself inside a lot. Riots and unrest were all around. It was the French Revolution, after all. She found refuge in her father's library. Maths was her favourite subject, and she taught herself as much as she could. She was particularly taken with the story about the demise of Archimedes. So preoccupied with the geometric figure he drew in the sand, he didn't notice the Roman soldier who was interrogating him. The soldier speared him to death. Surely if someone would die under such circumstances, then maths must be the most interesting, most engrossing subject of them all. She was hooked. Her enthusiasm, paired with the child's energy, was quite off-putting to her parents. It was pretty normal for girls of her time and class to learn a little bit of maths, enough to maintain a polite conversation, but this was pathological. She spent many nights up late studying. Her parents resorted to taking her candles and clothes in an effort to get her to go to bed. But she stayed up anyway, wrapped in blankets in the dim light of some candles she'd stolen. Her parents eventually relented. The reign of terror persisted through her teenage years, and she spent her time teaching herself differential calculus. As she outgrew her solo studies, she attempted to gain admission to the newly established École Polytechnique, still one of the most highly ranked, prestigious learning academies in the world even today. But it turns out that they were like her parents and that they didn't want her studying maths either. They would not admit women.
Luckily, her creativity wasn't constrained simply to maths. She took a lateral approach, eavesdropping lectures from the university hallway. She was enraptured by Joseph Louis Lagrange and his new course on analysis.
Eventually, she actually found the name of someone who dropped out. Monsieur Antoine Auguste Leblanc. Sorry, my French is terrible. She assumed his identity in order to participate in the classes. She filled in homework and submitted it under his name and read the materials that were sent to him because the École didn't actually know that he dropped out.
Lagrange noticed a marked improvement in the work of Monsieur Leblanc and sought him out for a meeting. He was, unsurprisingly, surprised upon meeting Mademoiselle Germain instead. He was impressed not only by her mathematical aptitude, but her resilience, enthusiastic even, a relief for her as she had reservations about turning up at all.
He started tutoring her and got her in touch with a lot of other mathematicians around Europe, including Legendre, which is how she discovered number theory, one of her first true mathematical loves. Aww. One of her other correspondents was the heavyweight Carl Gauss. She was a really big fan of his recent work and was suffering a little bit of imposter syndrome when she wrote, so she reassumed Monsieur Leblanc's name. She was working on Fermat's last theorem at the time, and though it wouldn't be solved in her lifetime, she did solve a little bit.
Fermat's last theorem is a fairly famous problem, mostly for how Fermat trolled the mathematical community by stating that he had solved the problem, but the margin in his book was too small for him to bother to write it down. It boils down to Pythagoras' theorem, a squared plus b squared equals c squared, and you can make whole number solutions like the classic 3-4-5 triangle. But are there any positive integer solutions where the 2s are replaced with 3 or more? For the case of 1 and 2, there are infinitely many solutions, but the theorem states that there are no solutions for any arrangement of numbers with exponents of 3 and higher, not a single one. Let P be an odd prime. If there exists an auxiliary prime R, which equals 2nP plus 1, n is any positive integer not divisible by 3, such that, number 1, if x to the p plus y to the p plus z to the p is equivalent to 0 mod R, then R divides xyz and, number 2, p is not a pth power residue mod R, then the first case of Fermat's last theorem holds true for p. That's a mouthful.
Her approach was fresh, trying a generalized solution rather than specifics, though all of the solutions that she found were primes under 100. Gauss was so impressed, in fact, that he responded to her letter, putting aside his contempt for the problem. A whole class of primes are named for her now, called Sophie Germain primes, where 2p plus 1 is also a prime. Sophie Germain primes and their friends safe primes, where p minus 1 over 2 is also a prime, are used in cryptography today, as well as an algorithm to test the primeness of other numbers when a full factorization would take way too long.
In 1806-ish, the French army were invading Prussia. Sophie was haunted by the story she read as a child, worried that Gauss would succumb to the same fate as Archimedes. She wrote to her family friend, an army general, and urged him to locate Gauss and protect him.
When Gauss got a knock at his door saying that Sophie Germain had sent for him, he was, who? It was only in a letter later on that Sophie revealed her true identity to Gauss, and Gauss was already impressed with his correspondent's deft creativity, and even more so finding out that it was a woman behind the mask. He praised her for her courage and intellect, especially with all of the sexism that she faced, because he acknowledged that made it exponentially more difficult for her to learn mathematics. Their letters flung back and forth across Europe for a few years, but after Gauss was appointed professor of astronomy at the University of Göttingen, he stopped responding to her letters. She was disappointed, but her attention was also drawn to something a little bit more practical. She began to study physics. She had seen some lectures by Ernest Chladni, who was recreating some demonstrations done originally by Robert Hooke, where you sprinkle powder across a plate, and then you would bow the edge of the plate with a bow, and all these weird shapes, all these sinuous patterns would appear in the powder where it settles in different lines and spots. The plate is oscillating, vibrating at a particular frequency of a whole family of frequencies called a standing wave.
If you were to picture the sound emanating from the plate, you would notice the spots where the sand settles are the same points where the wave amplitude is zero. At the clear places, the waves are at their highest or lowest amplitude, energetic enough to vibe the sand right out of the way.
If you could perform the same experiment on a guitar string, so that's just one dimension, the sand would settle at the harmonic points.
Or it's a bit easy to see on this demonstration with a chain.
Many mathematicians and physicists thought it would be impossible to describe these patterns out of the realm of what mathematics could do. Even her old tutor Lagrange said that a whole new kind of science would be required. Around 1809, the French Academy of Sciences put together a contest to see if there were any ideas out there about how to solve this problem. Turns out there were, and Sophie Germain got to work on her paper. The only other person who was working on it was Poisson, who was appointed to the Academy while the contest was still going. Her background in calculus gave her the skills that she needed to put together a pretty good argument, but her self-taught skill set just fell short. Her first submission was found to be lacking by the judges, but still a revolutionary new approach, and Lagrange actually used some of her ideas to formulate a solution for special cases. She rewrote the paper and submitted a second time, but again it was knocked back. But turns out third time's the charm, and in 1816 she won the award, the first woman to be awarded such a prestigious accolade from the French Academy of Sciences. But of course she wasn't allowed to attend the ceremony, because the only way a woman could go into the academy was if she was married to a member. Previous work on elasticity tended to only deal with one dimension, but you kind of need to have multiple in order to describe things, you know, moving in 3D and also through time. So to do that, you need partial differential equations, which was still a bit new and unwieldy, a bit of a mathematical enfant terrible.
Differential equations are one of the two pillars of calculus. It's a way to work out how a function's output changes as the input changes. When you hit the brakes in your car, you can imagine a chart of how your velocity changes, and it's going down. Your velocity changes over time. Remembering rise over run, these little triangles stand for change, and the angle of the slope tells you your acceleration, which is the derivative of velocity with respect to time. And here it's negative, deceleration. You can quantify lots of things in their relationships with differential equations, a ratio of two differentials in Leibniz's notation. You can also write the situation x f of x, which nicely labels the output paired with the input. We actually didn't use calculus yet in this example, rather algebra and geometry. I'm just skimming over the very basic idea of differentiation here. Calculus takes this principle and allows you to find out the slope of lines that curve as well.
If you want to describe a 2D surface like a plate, you need to take account for both the x and y directions, written like f of x, y. The way the function changes in either direction is independent from one another, and you need to differentiate one dimension while holding the other constant. So, let's use an example. Okay, so let's call this view the x dimension.
As you can see, it has this curve, like a parabola. So f of x is something like negative x squared. Let's keep this high point in mind and turn around to look at the y dimension. While looking at the y dimension, we're sticking with this high bit and not moving along the x axis anymore, which is now backwards and forwards. And we're also not moving up or down, which is actually our assessment of the function f of y. Nice! It's a straight horizontal line, some kind of constant, because it's not angled up or down, or curved at any point.
The old hyperbolic ones would have had curvature in this direction as well.
Now we have the functions f of x and f of y. We can differentiate them separately. Our notation looks a little bit different now. Those d's are the proper calculus form of the triangles we saw before. And thankfully, these functions are nice and simple. Differentiating negative x squared equals negative 2x, and differentiating any constant is zero. Whew!
And you can have as many variables as you like, but as soon as the visual metaphor starts to break down, that's where the notation comes in handy. And as we can see, it's a Leibnizian ratio of differentials, which looks like this. Oof!
So Sophie's explanation of the Chladni plates involves the independent x, y, z, and time dimensions, with the n squared as an elasticity scale factor for particular material. And those curly d things specify it's a partial differential equation. I'll leave some links below if you want to dive deeper. It's over my head at this point. She didn't invent partial differential equations, but her work was a breakthrough none of her contemporaries were able to make. And it's the basis for the modern theory of elasticity and acoustics. Engineers, musicians, luthiers, material scientists, architects all draw from the work she did quantifying the phenomena. One of the other professions who owe a debt to her, bizarrely, is quantum physics. When Schrödinger was formulating his wave equation, he didn't begin from scratch. He looked up a list of acoustic formulae, one that was filled up by Sophie and her peers for their work on the Chladni plates.
So through my research, I didn't actually find anybody crediting her while recounting the formative years of quantum mechanics, even while name-dropping her collaborators and contemporaries. I'm looking at you, Yale lecture series with the comments turned off.
Schrödinger's wave equation describes a probability density in 3D space. Electrons cluster around an atom's nucleus in shapes called orbitals. The densest parts, like wave pigs, are where an electron is most likely to be found.
For atoms with a single electron, the wave shape is essentially the same as the acoustics of a humming plate. A few years later, in 1821, she published an annotated version of her award-winning paper with her own revisions and advice from Augustin Cauchy. Further developing her elasticity theory, she described mean curvature, which is a handy tool in multivariable calculus and differential geometry. So imagine you're standing on a hill and you spin around, not too fast, and you take the average of the angle of the slope running away from you.
Using this information, you can also define the minima, the lowest part of your landscape, where your water bottle rolls to when you clumsily drop it, taking a sip after your hike. Minima surface, mean curvature definition. A surface M is a proper subset of the reals in three dimensions, is minimal if and only if its mean curvature is equal to zero at all points.
Minimum surfaces are useful in fluid mechanics, and one of the classic examples is the shape that happens when you blow bubbles! How the soap film sits around and between the air cavities is nature solving a minimum surface problem. The mean curvature everywhere on this object is zero. There are a few ways to find a minimum surface in dimensions other than the reals in 3D, one of them being the second derivative test. And these are optimization problems, and optimization problems are hugely important in the fields of computer science and engineering.
Her work is so far-reaching, and though she is relatively well-renowned in number theory with her work on prime numbers, she did so much more. Engineering, acoustics, cryptography, calculus, geometry, quantum mechanics. And though her work goes largely uncredited, she's actually one of the best documented and most well-known female mathematicians in history.
I mean, this book on differential geometry has a chapter on Gaussian and mean curvature, but it could just as easily say Gaussian and Germanian curvature. There are a lot of principles in science named for their discoverers, but I think it can be very fruitful to look behind the history of things that have a vague descriptive name. Towards the end of the 1820s, she developed a pain in her chest, breast cancer. For several years, she worked through the pain, driven by that same relentless enthusiasm of a cold, candlelit child that she carried through her life. She expanded her elasticity theory to movements in solids. But her cancer was progressing. Sadly, 2 years later, working all the while, at age 55 in 1831, she had passed away. Gauss organized for an honorary doctorate to be awarded to her from the University of Göttingen for her contributions to physics and maths, though she had no formal training, no formal education, and no academic ties. Though sadly, this only came to fruition after she died, and she never received her PhD in person. It's possible the circumstances that made her an outsider gave her a vantage point to come at problems like Fermat's last theorem and the Chladni plates from a different angle to those who were entrenched in the education systems of the time. On the other hand, who knows how much more she could have contributed to the field with the right resources and support. Her connections with Lagrange, Legendre, Gauss and others acted like lightning rods, sparking her creativity. The lone genius is a myth, but she's probably one of the people who came closest. Her persistence and creativity is something to be admired even hundreds of years later, and still a lot of people aren't on her frequency. Well, thanks for watching. I might see you on another video that I've got linked somewhere, and I'll have another one out soon enough. So yeah, don't forget to like and subscribe.